the passes through this small foramen, which named hiatus canalis nervi petrosi majoris. Hiatus canalis nervi petrosi majoris. It's very small groove. Here it is. Through which hiatus canalis nervi petrosi majoris. Small foramen through which this nerve passes on anterior surface of pyramis. Here it is. Hiatus canalis nervi petrosi majoris. And then we can find sulcus nervi petrosi majoris. Sulcus. Sulcus nervi petrosi majoris. Here it is. Sulcus nervi petrosi majoris. So this nerve, nervus petrosus major, will pass in anterior direction to the place of foramen lacerum. Here it is, foramen lacerum. Foramen lacerum. Okay. And now let's return to our picture. So, through hiatus canalis nervi petrosi majoris passes nervus petrosus major, and then it will enter to the fossa pteriga palatina, where ganglion pteriga palatinum is placed. GPTP. Ganglion pteriga palatinum. And we draw here synapse and postganglionic neurons will reach the glandula lacrimalis. These of yellow color nerves will innervate glandula lacrimalis. It's nervus lacrimalis. It's interesting that nervus lacrimalis belongs to the trigeminal nerve, but nervus petrosus major belongs to facial nerve. It means that preganglionic fibers, preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, which here is of green color, they are part of nervus facialis. But postganglionic parasympathetic fibers, which will innervate the effector glandula lacrimalis, they are fibers of trigeminal nerve. And ganglion pterygo palatinum is the place where preganglionic and postganglionic fibers will be meet with together and have a synapse. So, from nucleus elevatorius superior, we finally have innervated glandula lacrimalis. So lacrimation, tearing, will be the result of this activation of nucleus salivatorius superior. Then another very interesting Interesting. Branches, also of yellow color, they passes through foramen sphenoplatinum. Here it is, foramen sphenoplatinum. This small round structure, foramen sphenoplatinum. Foramen sphenoplatinum leads us into nasal cavity, and these fibers will innervate mucus sheet of nasal cavity. You can remember that when we lacrimate, also there is a secretion from nasal cavity. It's always together, because secretion of glandula lacrimalis and mucous gland of nasal cavity will be result of activation the same nucleus salivatorius superior. And then now I've drew third yellow fiber, which passes from ganglion pteriga palatinum into oral cavity, mucus of oral cavity. From ganglion pteriga palatinum, from fossa pteriga palatinum, we can reach the oral cavity through CPM. What is CPM? Canalis palatinus major. Canalis palatinus major. Now I shall demonstrate you canalis palatinus major. Here it is. Canalis palatinus major. So canalis palatinus major is a connection between oral cavity and fossa pteriga palatina. So canalis palatinus major is a place through which the postganglionic fibers will reach, return, the mucus of oral cavity. So this third yellow branch enters to the oral cavity through canalis palatinus major. And this is canalis incisivus. Canalis incisivus also helps to reach the mucous sheet of palatum durum. So I'd like to remember that third branch of fifth cranial nerve, that means nervus mandibularis, it passes through foramen ovale. It's written here, FOVA, foramen ovale. And here, of violet color, three of five, third branch of fifth cranial nerve, which means nervus mandibularis. So this is nervus mandibularis. And it's interesting. Nervus mandibularis is sensor afferent nerve which innervates first two of third part of the tongue. Here we demonstrate the tongue. This is the linea terminalis, which divide tongue to the anterior two-third part and posterior one-third part. And nervus mandibularis, this sensor nerve, it reach this region. And for us, it's very important now to demonstrate that together with sensoric fibers of nervus mandibularis, we can find also another blue fiber, which belongs to nervus facialis also. What is it? You can distinguish that it passes into cavum tympani, and this foramen through which it passes, it's fossula petrosa or apertura inferior canaliculi tympanici. Fossula petrosa, or apertura inferior canaliculi tympanici. It's very important. Fossula petrosa. How we can find this place? First of all, this is foramen caroticum externum. Foramen caroticum externum. Foramen caroticum externum. Okay. Here it is. Close to this place, we can find another foramen jugulare. Foramen jugulare. Foramen jugulare. Here it is. So, between these two foramina, we can find a small fossula. Here it is. Between these two foramina. Fossula petrosa. Again, this is fossula petrosa. And for us, it's important that through this small foramen passes these fibers, return to our presentation. This fiber of blue color, which enter to the cavum tympani. But we understand that if there is a sensoric fibers, there are sensoric fibers, so it should be also a special sensoric ganglion. And here it is, so named ganglion geniculi. There are numerous pseudo-unipolar neurons one branch of which directed to the periphery, to the tongue, and another branch of which should be directed into the center, that means in central nervous system. And now I demonstrate the second branch. It will reach to the nucleus, tractus solitarii, and as nucleus, tractus solitarii. Nucleus, tractus solitarii. This nerve, which contain two types of fibers, one of it is of blue color, it means sensoric fiber, another is of green color, it means parasympathetic preganglionic fibers. This nerve is designated as nervus horda tympani. It's nervus horda tympani. This nerve innervates both tongue with taste feelings. Our possibility to distinguish any sensation of taste, and also after synapse in ganglion submandibulare, it will innervate also glandula submandibulare and sublinguale. It's written glandula sublinguale, and we can understand that it's innervated from this nerve, nervus horda tympani. Glandula submandibulare is placed on the cervix, on the column. Glandula sublinguale is placed inside of the oral cavity, but both of them are innervated from nervus horda tympani. Again, these yellow fibers are postganglionic, and green fibers are preganglionic. They belong to different nerve. Nervus horda tympani belongs to the fascial nerve, and postganglionic nerves to glandula sublingualis, submandibularis belongs to trigeminal nerve. So practically we finished our picture, but before demonstrate you another slide, I'd like to speak about the classification. We know that there are 12 cranial nerves, and the seventh cranial nerve is nervus facialis. But sometimes you can read the textbook that there is not 12 but 13 cranial nerves, because these two nuclei, nucleus salivatorius superior and nucleus tractus solitarius, their fibers take place close to nervus facialis, but separately. And sometimes they are called as 13th cranial nerve. And for us, it should be understandable that nervus facialis, we can use this term in wide sense and in narrow sense. In wide sense, this is only motor nerve, which innervates only facial mimic musculature. But in this is in narrow sense. Motor nerve in narrow sense, but facial nerve in wide sense include also these sensoric and parasympathetic fibers. Just now we demonstrate the nervus facialis in wide sense. And now, nervus facialis in narrow sense. Do you understand the difference? Facialis in narrow sense is only of red color. It's motor nerve. But facialis in wide sense include also parasympathetic and afferent nerve fibers, and that's why it was drew with green and blue color. Okay, and now another slide. I promised it. Oh, here it is. Designation of the scheme. I propose that you make a print screen during your preparing to the classes from this slide to understanding each designation. Okay, and now let's continue. I'd like to show you this picture concerning the main branches of facial nerve. It isn't quite good in quality because it's from very ancient textbook, but we shall try to show it ourselves. So, schematic representation of facial nerve branching. I use this oval structure to demonstrate fissura, foramen sphenopalatinum. Here it is. Foramen sphenopalatinum. Foramen stilomastoideum. Foramen stilomastoideum. Through it, we can show that passes main radix of facial nerve. It includes motor fibers. Foramen stilomastoideum. So this is main radix of fascial nerve. And also close to it, we can find of green color fibers which are parasympathetic. Do I understand that if this is foramen stilum stratum, that means all branches which are above this foramen are inside of the cranium, and all branches which are which are above the which are down to this foramen are either on the cervix or on face. So let's continue. Branch which we drew just now is nucleus stapedius. Nervus stapedius. It's nervus stapedius. It's an inside of caum tympani. And these two small branches is nervus petrosus major and nervus horda tympani. So we can understand that inside of the cavum tympani from nervus facialis you can find branching three nerves: nervus petrosus major, nervus stapedius, and nervus horda tympani. We can also find that nervus stapedius is motor, but nervus petrosus major and nervus horda tympani are parasympathetic nerves. Then I use demonstration of ganglion geniculi, where fascial nerve make this angle, so named genus, geniculum, there placed ganglion geniculi. It's of blue color. Why? Because it's sensor. It's afferent. It contains afferent pseudo-unipolar neurons. And fibers from them accompanies nervus horda tympani for reach the tongue, for we can feel the taste from the tongue, from the mucus of the anterior part of the tongue. And after passing through foramen stilum stratum, all the fibers will be exactly motor. They exactly of red color. Let's try to distinguish them. First of it is nervus auricularis posterior, rudimental nerve, very small, very thin nerve, because usually we can't to move with our ears, with our